Welcome back to the intro to particle systems. In this video, we're going to start creating our second and final particle effect, which will be a fire effect, which is going to have multiple emitters. It's going to have a flame emitter, a smoke emitter, and a spark emitter. And in this specific video, we're going to take care of that first emitter, that flame emitter. So let's go ahead and get started. We'll pop open the generic browser. I'm still back in my Zach particles package. Let's right-click and create a new particle system. And I think I had this in the P systems group originally. Well, I think that's what I was working in earlier anyway. And let's do part underscore, and we'll call this fire effect. And press enter. Now, again, cascade comes up, and the first thing we need, of course, is an emitter. So let's right-click and create a new sprite or particle sprite emitter, excuse me. Now, as soon as you create your emitter, get into the habit of jumping in first thing and renaming your emitter, which, of course, you can do through the emitter name property or by right-clicking and going to emitter, rename emitter. I don't care how you do it, but make sure you do it.
That's just a good idea. If you end up with 6, 7, 8 different emitters, looking inside your emitter list, it's nice to be able to quickly tell what each of the emitters are responsible for doing.
That's right. So this will be our flame emitter, and currently these funny particles don't look anything like flames, so the next thing I'm going to do is change our material. So let's expand our required module. I'm going to bring up the generic browser, and over in the NVFX package, if I take my filter, I'm going to set this to a special word. I've already looked this guy up. We have the MFX Fire Offset 01, which is a material that came along with Unreal Tournament 3.
And since this is a material that has been put together for use inside of a particle system, do expect to see the particles disappear, because once again, it's going to have a vertex color material expression where it's looking for information to be coming from our particle system. So there we go.
Boop, that's right. Gone. As soon as I assign it, our particles disappear. If that ever scares you, make sure you click on wireframe.
It's still there.
Yeah, just show you that your particles are still trucking and everything's still good. Now, to make sure we have some particles that we can, you know, kind of work with, what I'm going to do is right-click and immediately add a color module. Now, in the last particle system we created, we added an initial color. And what that does is that assigns a color the moment a particle is born. Now, what we want to do is change the color. Actually, specifically, we want to change the alpha value over the life of the particle. So I'm going to go with color over life.
And while we're not going to focus on the actual color over its life, just the alpha, you can. You can make it a bit hotter, maybe a little more whitish orange.
Or maybe do the gas flame effect.
Get the blue in there.
It starts off blue at the base, and then as it goes out, it turns orange. There's all sorts of things you could do.
Exactly.
We're going to use a constant color, but then we're going to animate the alpha to cause our flames to fade out a little better than they
are. That's right. So the good news is we have particles back up in the preview window, so we'll bring our attention back to the color over life module in just a minute. Back up here on flame where we are at the moment, we've got some more things to set.
That's right. We're going to change our spawn rate a little bit. By default, this comes in at a constant of 20. We're going to set this to 25. So we got a few more flames.
Yeah, those extra 5 particles per second, so important.
Oh, that's what seals the deal as far as I'm concerned.
That's right.
All
right.
So down from here, we're going to go down to our lifetime module, and we're going to set this to a random range between 0.5 and 1. Now, I want to mention this real quick, just a tip for you to take home with you, and that is that min and max are not always listed in the same order among these distributions.
It's max, min.
Yeah, sometimes it's alphabetical. So just keep an eye out for that. Make sure you're setting the right value.
Because I can promise you, even the best of us have been burned by not paying attention and assuming the very first one is always min and the second one is always max.
Oh, the stories I can tell. Yeah. All right, let's jump down to initial size, and I'm going to set this to a range between 35 and 45. So notice here we have max on top and min on bottom. So min will be 35s down the board. Now, really, the only key guy here is X. Now, as a matter of habit, I set all 3 if I know that I want them all of the same value.
Yeah, it's a quick pop quiz. Why do we only have to set X?
Well,
come on, guys. Surely you remember.
I'll show you.
There you go.
We come back up here to our required module. Our screen alignment is set to PSA square.
It's always a square, so only the X value is going to be taken into account.
All right, so there's our initial size all set. Moving down from here, we're going to take a look at our initial velocity, which is currently pushing our particles up into the air pretty nicely. All I'm going to do is take our minimum value, which is currently set to 50 in Z. We're going to push that up to 75. So in general, we're speeding up
our particles. Up a little bit faster. You'll notice as Zach goes through and starts setting all of the different properties for our effect, one of the things he's going to continue to push is random numbers. Random numbers. This is really important in making a very fluent-looking effect like fire.
That's right. All right, now moving down from here, let's go down to color over life. And as I mentioned earlier, in our particular case, the color itself is going to be a constant. We're not going to be changing it over the life of the particle. So let's go over to our distribution, and we'll set this to a vector constant. So it's only one value. And if you just set this to 1 all the way down, you're actually getting the color of the material. I wouldn't mind this being just a tad more orange. So what I'm going to do is take our red value, and we could maybe push that up to 1.3. And you'll notice that really kind of starts to drive those reds, but we still keep that hot look where right. We're clipping out toward white. So we'll just go ahead and leave it there. Now, down from here, we have alpha over life. And this is the guy who's going to be really important, because if you take a look at our fire, you can't really tell that it's popping into existence.
Oh, yeah, you can. It looks rough. It's a real bad stutter or jitter down there at the bottom.
Well, there are so many particles layered on top of each other. It's not quite as apparent as it is at the top.
It gives that jitter effect. But the top, yeah, the top is very obvious because the particles are popping out of existence.
That's right. They're immediately gone. And that looks terrible. You don't want that. So what we're going to do is fade them out. Now, we're going to fade this by creating a curve that changes the value of our alpha over time. And to make sure that everybody understands how this works, I'm going to begin by wiping out any information that came with us.
This is the first time you guys are going to see how to actually go about creating a curve when working inside of Unreal Cascade. It's not like working with curves over in Matinee.
No, not at all.
In regards to generating your keyframes. Now, once you have a curve in place, working inside the curve editor is very much like working in the curve editor over in Matinee. But you can't just go over to the curve editor and hit the good old enter key to drop down a key. Here, you have to do it manually.
That's right. So the first thing I'm going to do is wipe out the points we have by clicking on the remove all items from array button.
And the second thing you're going to do is go ahead and take and send that curve from the module over to the curve editor so that they can see this thing build up.
I'm going to remove color over life. We don't really need to see that. Okay, first step is to add some point, because you'll notice as soon as our points were gone, we lost all our particles, because really it's like we have no alpha. So let's click add new item.
And a point just appeared over in the curve editor right there.
Navigate by dragging with the left mouse button, and you can see that right there. Notice it's got a value of 0, and it's at a time of 0. Now how do we set that? Well, we have a couple of options. If we wanted to, we could select the actual point over here in the curve editor. We could hold down control, and we could move it around.
Look at that. As soon as it came off 0, hello, we've got particles. And as Zach drags it up and down, it becomes more opaque and it becomes less opaque.
That's
or
right.
More transparent.
So as I drag it up above 0, also notice this, it won't let you drag it below 0. Mm-hmm. I love that. So I can drag it way up into the air, and we start really kind of super pushing our alpha beyond the norm. But actually, look, it's not beyond 1. It's actually capping up there, too.
Very nice.
Great stuff. So
there at the bottom, nice and transparent. So what we're looking for is a smooth transition over the life of the particle.
Now, it is absolutely cool if you want to create all of your curves just by adding a point over here inside of your properties window and then controlling the location of that point over here inside the curve editor.
Sure, nothing wrong with that.
It actually works great. Now, just for those of you who are following along so that we can have all the same values, I'm going to show you how you can also adjust these numerically over here inside the properties window. You have two important values. You have in value and out value, where in value is your point along the timeline.
Yeah, your time.
That's right. And then your out value is going to be the actual value, in this case, of your alpha, because that's what you're controlling.
So this can be really confusing to those that aren't used to seeing in value and out value representing time and value.
Yeah, you just got to keep it straight in your head. In value equals time, out value equals your property value.
And we can prove it real quick. Go ahead and set in val to 0.2. They're going to see a big jump. Boom, big jump.
That's right. Now, we want to set this at birth, so we're going to start off by setting our in value to 0, which, because remember, we're doing color over life, so 0 equals birth, 1 equals death. Now, let's take our out value, and we're going to leave this at 0, because when the particles are born, we want them to be completely transparent. Next, we're going to add another point, so let's go ahead and click the Add New Item button. Now we have points 0 and 1. Now, you can select this point over here, but it's a little tricky because it's stacked right on top of the original. So the next thing I'm going to do is change my in value to 0.25, which jumps the point over. And at this point, you could select you could select this inside the curve editor, hold down the control button, and start to move this around. Now, again, I'm going to set it literally inside the numeric fields just to make things easy on everyone. So this will have an out value of 1 and an inval of 0.25.
So in the first quarter of the particle's life. It's going to be completely transparent and work its way at the moment linearly from completely transparent to completely opaque. And you'll notice at the bottom where our particles are being spawned from right now, it's much smoother looking than it was a second ago when they were jittering really bad.
That's right. Now, I do want to mention this. I'm going to do something I'm going to fix. But if you take a point and hold down Control and you move it around, notice it's got a completely different inval and outval now. It's now at 0.44 along the timeline, and it has a value of 0.92. But our numbers over here didn't change. All you need to do is contract your values and then re-expand them, and it'll update.
There you go.
So just as a quick note about that. Also, one more thing, and this will get you. It can confuse you if you're not used to it. I could take, say, this point and drag it over here.
And it will switch things when you update it over inside your property.
That's right. If I close up my points and re-expand them, it's going to flip those values around. So now this is 0.0 and this is 0.1. So you don't really have to worry about it. You can build these in any order you want. And as long as you contract your points and re-expand them, everything's going to be straightened out for you.
And if you look up in your preview window, you can actually see the effect now as the particles are fading out at the top.
It's weird.
Ready to die.
It almost looks like there's a shadow right there.
Yeah, it does.
It's kind of strange. Anyways, let's put everything back the way it was, and I'll just do it by hand over here with the numbers. So inval will set to 0.
0 and 0.
And 0. And then for 1 will be
0.25 and 1.
That's right. Okay, so now we are ready to
I'm not 100% convinced you got that very first one.
I don't think I did. We need to make sure that's 0.
All right. There we go.
There we go. Now things are looking good. Let's go ahead and take a look at our third point along the curve. So we'll add point number 2, technically, because this is a zero-based counting system. And again, notice that all of our flames disappear because this third point has been added, and its in value is at 0. So it's like we're contradicting ourselves. We have a third point which is saying that at the beginning of your life, be 0.
Right.
And the curve is, in essence, kind of wrapping around. It's kind of, well, kind of confusing.
Kind of scary.
Yeah, kind of scary. We're going to set our outval, though, to 0.75. And we'll start getting some nice fade out to 0, but the problem here is that we're fading out to 0 only 3/4 of the way along the life of our particles. So we have a whole nother quarter of our lifespan where we don't even see our particles. So we're going to set our outval to 1, so we're holding this value all the way to the end of our life. And we can actually see that reflected.
And of course, now you can tell in the preview window that at the top they are once again popping out because we have yet to set up it to fade out.
Which means we need a fourth and final point, which we will set our in value to 1, and we'll leave our out value at 0, and now we are indeed fading out.
Very nice.
All right, things are looking really good here. The only thing I'm going to do, and it's a matter of personal taste. Me personally, however, just playing with particles and whatnot, I feel like I can actually see, or maybe it is just feel, that linear progression from mm-hmm. fading. And I would prefer this to be a smoother curve, so I'm going to hold down Control and Alt here in my curve editor, and we'll draw a marquee selection box around all of our points, and I'm going to set these over to auto tangents, and then I'm going to flatten the tangents to the axis. So we're smoothly fading in, and then we're smoothly fading out.
It's, very nice.
To me, it just looks a little better. Flame looks really hot, too, by the way.
Well, that's good. It's fire.
That's right. Okay, so there's that.
Much better. No longer jittering at the bottom, and it's not popping really hard at the top.
All right, now the next thing we want to do is change the nature of our creation so that we're not creating all of our flame particles from the exact same point. We're going to change that by adding an initial location module located under location. And this allows you to specify an area from which to fire out your particles. So let's take a quick look at this. Now, we do have a new button that appears here, so just so nobody gets confused. This is an indicator that we can turn on, and it just shows you this initial location. And as I make changes to the properties here, you're going to see this change shape a little bit to give you a graphical representation of the area from which you're emitting your particles.
Yeah, actually, yeah, exactly. You're going to see a plane that we're going to be using in just a minute for the emission. Right now, everything is set to 0, 0, and 0, so we're really emitting from a point. Now, as Zach goes through here and makes these changes, you're not going to see a lot of difference yet. There's a lot of different modules that really need to be stacked up inside this particular emitter here before we get the final fire effect. But here, Zach has gone in and set a -4 by +4 plane, and if he rotates, you can actually see the plane representation in the icon that's drawing right there where the particles are being emitted from.
Or we could, well, I guess if we turn it off, I don't see it. Although I can turn off rendering there.
So now you can see where they're coming out. In a minute, he's going to set it up so the particles start out at birth, Earth at a smaller size and then scale up. And it's going to help confine the effect just a little bit bigger. Now, of course, if he wanted to, he could have set that to, if you want to have fun for a second, do like minus 44 to 44.
Oh, sure.
I mean, we'll make it very noticeable. Look at that.
Oh, hang on. Whoops. I forgot my minus sign there. And we'll set this up to 44 and 44. So now we have this great big sheet of fire, but this is separating things a lot.
So much so that you would have to come back up to the emitter and crank up your spawn rate. There you go.
And now you've
now
got
the building's on fire.
Yeah,
quick, get out.
You're lighting everything on fire. So the pyromaniacs in the room are probably really digging this. But let's go ahead and turn things back down. I'm going to change values. We'll go with negative 5.
Okay.
I think that extra 1
is going to make all the difference in the world.
Again,
and it's going to sell the effect.
That's what's going to sell it. And that's a lot of fire.
That's a lot of particles.
That's a lot of particles. So let's
you now have a flamethrower that's pointing straight up.
Yeah. So we're going to pull that back down to, I think it was 25 a minute ago. All right, so when it's that low, you start to get some nice breakup in the...
Of course, right now you might be looking at this, if you're completely new to creating particle effects, you might still be looking at this thinking, it still just doesn't look right. That's because...
I'd agree with you.
And that's because at the moment we're not controlling everything that we can control to make this look like a nice fluent flame effect, where we have things like swirling flames where they're rotating around. And
well, you got to remember that in real life, fire is not a sheet of planes of the same picture over and over. And we don't have... I can't say we don't have, but in this particular case, we don't have access to several different pictures for our fire. So we've got to fake it a little bit. We're going to spin our flames around a little bit and make them look different. All right, the next thing though we want to do is to change the size of our little particles as they go through their life. And I'm going to do that with a size scale module. I almost said operator. So size scale, and what this will do is kind of act like a multiplier from the initial size.
Okay.
So let's come down and check out its properties. Now, I want to animate this. I want to change the value over time. So that is going to warrant that I bring in a curve. So let's go ahead and go to our distribution. We're going to add a vector constant curve. Excuse me. Now, this has no points by default.
Let's go ahead and send that curve on down to the curve editor.
Okay, I'll remove the alpha curve that's already over here, and let's send this down into the editor, and we'll create our first point, which has an inval of 0 and an outval of 0 as well.
So basically, we're saying at the birth of the particle, we would like for the particle size to be 0, 0, 0.
That's right, yeah. Again, notice that things are a little different now, where before we were working with a single scalar, a float.
So yeah, up under inval, it just put the outval, but now outval is actually 3 different properties.
And I'm going to set this, our inval is going to be 0.3, so at a third of the way along our lifespan, which in this case, because it's the first point, means from birth all the way up to a third of the way along our lifespan, we're going to have a value of 1. Now, if you want to, you can go ahead and set Y and Z as well, but because we're using PSA square, really the only one you're listening to is X. So we're, at a third of our life, we are all the way at 1, and then we're going to add a second point that's going to have an inval of 1, so at the end of our particle's life, and an outval of 0. So you can actually see the particles scaling away to nothing as they go up.
Mm-hmm.
And as you start to pull back, this is starting to look a lot more flame-like. Because
campfire or
something. In general, yeah, fire tends to taper as it goes up. Okay, so that's looking pretty good. I think the next thing we need to do is worry about the fact that all of our particles are oriented in the exact same way, because you can kind of see that. It looks a little cheesy if you look really close. So let me scroll down.
I will throw this in there real quick. Just a minute ago, I believe I said when we were talking about initial location that you were going to have them scale up. So if you guys want to do that,
sure.
As Zach here is just going about creating the effect as he sees necessary, then you can just go in there and add a point back at 0, and you just keep adding points, set up a curve that has a scaling
up. Do you want to make them scale up real quick? I'll be happy
to
do it. I'll be happy to do it. Watch this. Let's just go ahead and add point number 3 in this case. I mean, technically it's number 2, but it is a third point. And let's take its outval. I'm going to set it to 0.5 just so I know which one it is. And then let's come over here to the curve editor. I'll hold down control and we'll move this back to the beginning of our curve. And notice I have X, Y, and Z, but really it's only X that matters, so I can only move one point if I want to and I'll be just fine.
And this time he doesn't have to take it all the way down to 0. Even where he's got it now has already enhanced the effect just a little bit where it's not coming out. It's basically scaling up just a fraction of a hair.
That's right, but take a look at don't worry about what's going on in the properties window. Just look at the curve editor and notice that really all that matters is our X curve. In fact, we can hide out the Y curve and the Z curve if we want to. So let's go ahead and just pay attention to this guy.
There we go. Yeah.
So what we're doing is we can, say, scale all the way up from 0 or maybe scale up from 0.65.
Yeah, so it's a very subtle effect.
And then, again, because we have changed the order of our points, go ahead and collapse your point stack and expand it back out.
Very nice.
And
looking
there you go.
Good.
Now, it's just me. I'm not a big fan of these linear curves in terms of properties like this. So I'm going to set this over to auto. And once again, I don't really need to flatten the tangents, but I'm going to do it out of habit anyway. So we have a smooth transition going up to a certain size and back down. And that creates a nice billow for the flame, which
it
you can kind of feel right there at the base of it. Okay, so now let's deal with this rotation problem. I'm going to right-click here at the bottom of my little emitter list, and we'll add an initial rotation. And what this will do is just simply add a different rotation for each one of the particles as they come out. Now, by default, this is set on a value of 0 to 1, where 0 is no rotation, and 1 is 360 degrees of rotation. So that's going to work out perfectly. We don't even need to change this. But it would be nice if we spun the particles a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to right-click again, go back down to rotation rate this time, which is, again, rate would imply that you're changing it over time. And we're going to set an initial rotation rate. Let's take a look at its properties. It has a uniform distribution. We're going to set this from negative 0.25 to positive 0.25 so that we have fairly slow rotation and an equal opportunity for us to spin clockwise or counterclockwise.
Very nice looking.
So yeah, that's looking pretty good. And at this point, you know, we're essentially done with the flame effect. But don't be afraid to go in there and play with stuff. I mean, if you'd like to see maybe more flame particles, you could, of course, go in and change your spawn rate. You can change your initial size to do whatever you want it to do. You can play with your color over life. Have a little bit of fun and experiment a little bit. Or, of course, just follow along, because in the next video, we're going to be creating the smoke effect for our fire.
Now, let's go ahead and make sure to save our package, just in case anything happens. And
that's right.
We'd hate to lose our work. And yeah. I guess with that, that's pretty much going to wrap up this video. Thanks a lot.